All right, good morning. Good to see you today. Welcome to Faith Baptist Church. Those of you that are here in person and those of you as well that are watching on Facebook, we're glad that you're here today. Find your celebration hymnal. Let's stand together. We'll find a little chorus on page 118 that says, His name is wonderful and that His is the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's stand together and sing it out perhaps a couple of times, as unto the Lord, and then Brother Sellers to come and pray with us today. 118, if you need your book, sing it out. Amen. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. He's the great Shepherd, the Rock of all ages. Almighty God is He. Bow down before Him, love and adore Him. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. Let's sing it again. You sound so good this morning. Some songs you sing to God, and some songs you sing about Him. And this is a good one about Him. Amen. And His name, and not only His name, but He Himself is wonderful. Let's sing it out. Amen. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, the Master of everything. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. He's the great Shepherd, the Rock of all ages. Almighty God is here. Bow down before Him, love and adore Him. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my
a blessing when we're singing like that a cappella, when we make melody in our heart to the Lord. Thanks for being here today, especially again those join us by Facebook. But glad for all of you here, especially if you're visiting with us. We appreciate you being a part of the service. Let's have a word of prayer and ask the Lord to bless our time together. Our Father, thank you for life, breath, health. Thank you for a great country that we live in. And Lord, again, we pray for our nation that we'd turn back to you in faith and repentance, and that our nation would be on the right path. Thank you for the opportunity to be in church today, again, where we can fellowship with each other, worship you in spirit and truth, and try and encourage one another. And it's just been an encouragement to see some folks here today. It's just encouraged me and lifted my spirits, and I want to thank you for that. Bless our time around your word. Give us something from it that when we leave, we'll be better than when we came in. And Father, we'll give you praise, honor, and glory for all you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can be seated.
In that same hymn book, hymn number 344. Miss Lori's out of town today, so I appreciate your help as we sing some good songs to the Lord today. We'll sing this good song. Let's do verse 1, 2, and 4, and then we'll have some announcements. And Miss Stacy's going to come and sing for us later, and we'll look forward to that. Amen. Grace greater than my sin. 344. Let's sing it out. As unto the Lord. Amen. Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Sin and despair like the sea waves cold threaten the soul with infinite loss. Grace that is greater, yes, grace untold, points to the refuge, the mighty cross. Marvelous grace, infinite grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Marvelous grace, infinite grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see His face, will you this moment His grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Marvelous grace, infinite grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. Isn't that great? What a wonderful thought. It doesn't matter how much you've sinned, God's grace will wipe it all away. Amen. Wasn't that a tremendous, tremendous truth today? Just a couple of quick announcements. Pardon me. This is obviously our last Sunday in the month of June. The family's been our focus for this month as we try to get things back in, headed at least in the right direction. Next Sunday is God and Country Sunday, the fourth being on Saturday, and obviously the fifth will be Sunday. We'll have one service that morning, no evening service, and we will eat together dinner on the grounds after that morning. So come prepared to do just that. And I think Miss Sellers needs to meet with the ladies this morning after the service to discuss those things. So ladies, this morning, after the invitation, if you'd meet up front here with Miss Sellers just for a little while, we'll try to plan out what we're going to do for next Sunday. We'll be catering the food from Eric's Eatery. Amen. Just a local establishment here in town. But Eric's going to be cooking for us, doing some grilling, and we look forward to that. So we'll bring the fixings and the homemade ice cream. Daddy, I was told to say that. And other things that we'll share together. That's next Sunday. So come expecting the Lord to work in our lives as we celebrate not only the goodness of the Lord, but the goodness of America, patriotism, and all the things that we love about this country. Amen. All right, I think that's it as far as announcements. We'll let you know if something else comes up. Let's pray. Ask God to bless the remainder of our service. Miss Leah is going to come sing for us first, and then we'll continue with our service after that. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your goodness, for your mercy, for your grace, for your kindness, for your long-suffering, gentleness, patience, all the things, Lord, that you are and all the things that I'm not. We thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, who without him we have no help and no hope, but with him we have everything. Thank you for the blood of Jesus that cleanses us from our sins. And may we, Lord, boldly say that we belong to him. Lord, bless our nation. We're certainly in turmoil, and we see just the results of folks that either turn their back on you or refuse to accept you. Mercy is what we need. Grace, and like we just sang about. Bless them, the remainder of our service. The preacher is going to come preach to us here in a few minutes. And Lord, when he does, use your word to speak to our hearts, and we'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name we ask, amen.
You know what Jesus did for you, say amen. Man, that if that didn't bring a smile to your face, maybe you need the Lord to do something for you. But it was a great miracle. A lot of things the Lord's done in our lives, but if you think back, the greatest one was when he saved your soul from an eternal hell, and you were to give him praise and honor and glory for that. Maybe you don't want to jump up and run around the room, but surely in your heart there's a lot of praise going up to God for the fact that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and we rejoice at that. I want to say a special thank you to not only all of you that are here today, but those who are listening out in the airways there, but by virtue of the fact that so much support has come in. Y'all been very good
We haven't been passing the offering plate. We just put it in the back. People have been putting their offerings in. Folks have been sending things in. People out in the audits have been doing that as well. And I just want to thank you for helping, realizing the need of the church, and you've been faithful to give. And I give God the glory for it. But thank you all for being faithful and being there to support your church and to back it. It means an awful lot in these difficult days. As a lot of churches around this country that are facing some very difficult times, some have even had to close their doors because of the COVID-19 and the impact that that's had on the economy of their community, or it's had on the financial situation for many of the members of their churches, and I'm sure it's impacted you, many of you maybe in a negative way. But y'all have hung in there and made sacrifices, and I really appreciate it. And our missionaries appreciate it greatly as well. I had the privilege this week to go up, fly up to Ohio. Thank y'all for praying for me. We landed safely there, got back and landed safely, and that's always a good flight. And I had to wear one of those masks, you know, the whole time on the plane. I cannot stand that. I absolutely despise it. But I had to. But had a great time. Wonderful experience there, and the church up there gave me a special gift that they're having to ship back because it would not fit in my suitcase. So as soon as it arrives, it's a church I went to and preached a couple times back in 15 and 16. I'll show it to you. So I hope to have it by next Sunday for God and Country Day. Now, I want to encourage you to be back tonight at 6 for the evening service, but do your best to be here. God and Country Day is always special. I'm glad that I live in America. We've got our problems. There's a lot of things I want to get fixed. I pray that our nation will repent and turn back to God and will obey 2 Chronicles 7:14. I really want to see that happen. But even if it doesn't, I'm still thankful that I live in America and that I have the privileges that I have. And God's been good to us as a nation in a lot of different ways. And we got a big election coming up. There's a lot of reasons why we need to focus on our God first and our country second. But I encourage you to be here next week. I think it'll be a great time. You'll enjoy the music, you'll enjoy the fellowship, and you'll enjoy the food. And I know it'll be a great blessing to you. All right, brother.
All right, let's stand together, please, and we'll sing our hand waving song. And you may find that on 609. And we'll just sing the first verse together. Miss Stacy, after that, will come and sing for us. And then we'll turn our service over to our preacher. 609, there's not a friend like the lowly Jesus, no, not one. Amen. Let's sing the first verse together. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus, no, not a one, no, not a one. None else could heal all our souls' diseases. No, not a one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not a one, no, not a one. Find somebody and wave to them heartily as unto the Lord. Amen. And Miss Stacy will make her way up, and we'll have our special this morning. And when you've waved till your heart's content, you may be seated. Amen. All right. Appreciate you being here today. Thank you, Miss Leah, for a good song already. And now Miss Stacy's going to sing, and then the preacher will come.
As I look into the mirror, I know I wouldn't be here if not for you. When I caused you so much pain, and you could have turned away, your faith held true. When my life had turned to ashes, and my dreams went up in smoke, you were the constant light my only source of hope. You saved me each and every turn. As I stood frozen on the bridges I would burn, you saved me when I was my own worst enemy. Your love is the key that set me free. Lord, you saved me. When I look up at the cross and consider all it cost, I stand amazed. When I'm driven to my knees, 'cause my mind cannot conceive your endless grace. You know the very number, every hair upon my head. You love me and you chose me before I took my first breath. You saved me each and every turn. As I stood frozen on the bridges I would burn, you saved me when I was my own worst enemy. Is the key that set me free. Lord, you saved me. You saved.
Take your Bibles this morning. Let's turn to the book of Ephesians in the New Testament. We've been focusing this month on the family. And this will be the last in the series of messages on the family. But I want to read to you from the book of Ephesians. I'm going to turn to one other place, and you can join me if you'd like, and that's Genesis chapter number 2. So Genesis chapter 2 and Ephesians chapter number 5. If you'd like to join me, both places that I'd like to read to you this morning. How many of you are a little warm in the building this morning? Would you raise your hand? Thank you. We're not going to do anything about it. We just want to know if you were, just want to know if you was warm or not. Miss Sandra's sitting there with a sweater on, and everybody else is sweating this morning. So we'll make sure we get the air going good here in a few minutes maybe. But I want to share with you some thoughts today. Look with me in, I'll read there, and you can look with me in Genesis chapter number 2. The Bible says this in the very next to the last verse. Verse number 24, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. In Ephesians chapter number 5, notice with me if you would, verse number 31. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. The message I want to preach to you this morning, I have entitled it as the Lord's Building Code. And I want to preach to you about that this morning. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for your word. Bless it in our hearts today. And I pray in the moments that I have to speak to the ear of these people that your Holy Spirit will speak to their heart. Do something in us today that a man cannot take credit for, but we'll give you glory for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. A number of years ago, actually it was 2007, my wife and I were able to build a house.
I'm very grateful that we had that privilege and opportunity. But we found out something was different in 2007 that was not true in 1985 when I first came here. And that is that our county and city actually had a building code. Back in the day, everybody kind of did things. I mean, they used some particular electrical and plumbing codes. But as far as the building codes in the city and the community, there was not one for a number of years. But we found out for sure there was one, and so we had to go by it in order to do it. Almost every city or municipality has a building code nowadays, so you got to meet code if you're going to get a certificate of occupancy in a building like we're in today. So you have a certain requirement in the materials that are used as well as the labor that's involved. I'm reminded, as you think about it, though, what we're reading here is God has a requirement. That's what a code is. God has a guideline. That's what a code is to go by when it comes to building facilities. But God has one for the family unit. God has one for marriage. And so I'll be talking a good bit about that this morning. So the Lord's building code, essentially this morning, what we're looking at is that a man leaves his father and mother and joins unto his wife. So we're going to talk about the Lord's building code in regard to marriage and family. I'm reminded of one pastor who went to speak to a group of fourth graders on the topic of marriage. He was going to explain to them how wonderful it is and all that. And so he asked this question, does any one of you know what God has to say about marriage? Immediately, a little fourth grade boy threw his hand up and said this, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Someone has observed this. Man is incomplete until he's married, and then he's finished. Someone else said, if love is a dream, then marriage is the alarm clock that wakes you up. One man said this, I never knew what real happiness was until I got married, and then it was too late. Married life is very frustrating, it's been said. In the first year of marriage, the man speaks and the woman listens. In the second year, the woman speaks and the man listens. In the third year, they both speak and the neighbors listen to everything. This is a true story by a German poet. He said this, Heinrich Heine. He left his entire estate when he died to his wife with one condition. She must remarry. When asked why he made that a requirement, he said, I want to know that at least one other man will regret my death. I'm sorry, that's not my joke. That's a true statement that he made. Now, in spite of all that, we can joke and laugh about it, but in spite of all that, marriage, or mowage as some pronounce it, is still a good idea. And you know why it's still a good idea? Because it was God's idea, and he's never had a bad idea. Everything he comes up with, and this was established even in the Garden of Eden before man and woman, Adam and Eve, sinned there. But there is an essential ingredient that is the number one code that has to be observed if marriage would meet God's requirements, and that is, and I want you to remember this word today, that is the word commitment. It is the number one thing when it comes to marriage and relationship. It is commitment. One gentleman by the name of Nick Stinnett, a doctor at the Department of Human Development of the Family at the University of Nebraska, did a very intensive study. He studied some 3,000 families. They weren't all one race. They were from many different countries, including South America, Switzerland, Austria, Germany, South Africa, as well as the United States. It wasn't just Christian people, but he did a survey of all marriage relationships in this, and this is what they came up with about some characteristics of strong families. Number one, they spend time together. Number two, they have good family communication. Number three, they express appreciation to each other. Number four, they have a spiritual commitment. Number five, they're able to solve problems in a crisis. And number six, which he highlighted, they are committed to the family. The one single element that makes the biggest difference that must be adhered to with the Lord's building code is this thing called commitment. Commitment brings satisfaction and hope and joy. No commitment, no lasting satisfaction. No commitment, no lasting joy. No commitment, no real blessings in that marriage or in that home. Commitment must be there. What I read to you in Genesis, the Genesis passage, it speaks about a man leaving father and mother. That's a decision made and then cleaving unto his wife, and the wife cleaving to her husband. That relationship, so there's a decision made to move into a commitment phase when people make a commitment and actually keep it. They say in the study of the words there that the word cleave means literally be glued or cemented together. Now, when I think of glue, one of the first, of course, I'm usually thinking of duct tape, but if I think of glue, I'm thinking of the quick drying, crazy glue, super glue, instantly. But that's not the kind of glue that's talking about. It's talking about the kind of bond that is cemented together, and as time goes by, day in, day out, even year in and year out, that bond gets more cemented, more concrete. One preacher said it this way, you know, it's real easy to pronounce somebody, man and wife, than it is to have them become one as man and wife. I've conducted several wedding ceremonies over my span in the ministry, and I found out that I can say at the end of it, I now pronounce you man and wife. You may kiss the bride, and then I present them, Mr. and Mrs. John Smith, to the audience, and they go out. But just because you pronounce it does not mean it'll last. See, what it amounts to is this, that the preacher's call or someone's prayer is not going to be fulfilled unless that code that God has in His Word of being committed and sticking together is adhered to. It is God's way of saying this is the way it's supposed to work. I've certainly been disappointed over time to watch some couples. Somebody said it's kind of a little bit like baptism. You know, you need to start doing it, baptizing and marrying people in syrup. That way it would at least stick. But the truth is, we don't have any guarantee. There's no way we as preachers or friends can ever guarantee. And I've often been disappointed at somebody I marry, and 6 months later, 6 years later, in some case, 20 plus years later, a marriage breaks up and a home falls apart. Now, I know there's a lot of reasons, but I would submit to you this morning that one of the big reasons that there are breakups is because there's a lack of real commitment of becoming one flesh, as the Lord describes in His Word. James Dobson, of Focus on the Family, many years ago said this, married life is a marathon. It is not enough to make a great start, but it has to be a long-term commitment to lasting. Now, three particular things I want to share with you today that I think commitment surrounds in regard to marriage and family relationships. Number one, there must be a commitment. That's the word. A commitment to a loving marriage. Notice with me in the passage I read in the book of Ephesians chapter 5. Look back at verse number 25. Husbands, what's that next word? Love your wives. Look at verse number 33, if you would. Here it says, nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself. And the wife, see that she reverenced her husband. Somebody said this about women. They said, sometimes wives are the opposite of fishermen. They brag about the ones that got away and complain about the ones they caught. But marriage has to be filled with the kind of love that is caring, that is sharing, and is understanding. Now, listen, nobody in this room is perfect. We all make our mistakes and we mess up along the way. But we have to be committed to getting back to where we need to be. And if the loves have drained out, get back to where there's a commitment to genuine love in a marriage. Everybody knows this if you've been married any length of time. My wife and I have been married for a long time, and I'm trying to calculate the numbers in my head right now. But I believe if you go back, we got married in 1976, so we just hit the 44-year mark. So that's a long time that's gone by. In that amount of time, what's happened? There's been ups and downs. There's been times that she's loved me. There's been times she ain't loved me probably much as she should. There's been times I've loved her, and there's been times I hadn't loved her quite as much as I should. There's ups and downs. There's times when maybe everybody's like, man, that's just so wonderful to be in love. Till the light bill comes in, and why didn't you pay that bill? And, you know, different things. But here's the thing. Are you listening to me? You're not always, y'all need to hear this. You're not always in love. In the feeling of the emotion, oh, it's just wonderful to be in love with you. Well, if you talk like that all the time, something's wrong. You've been watching way too much Hallmark Channel as far as I'm concerned. But here's the thing. I'm not talking about a commitment to being in love. That's not what I said. It's a commitment to love. So when maybe there's friction and you're not getting along like you should, you've got to be committed to love one another through those moments. You're going to be in the down moments, you've got to love through them. You're going to be in the up moments, you've got to love through them. Sometimes it's just an even keel and nothing particular, but you've got to love one another through that. C.S. Lewis said it this way, every marriage seemed to have its periods of death and resurrection. He attributed so much divorce among Christian believers to their not waiting out those deadly periods, the winter months, if you will, of marriage until the spring or the resurrection arrived. I ran across this, you might appreciate this, of before and after falling in love. Before, you take my breath away. After, I feel like you're suffocating me. Before, she loves the way I take control of the situation. After, she called me a controlling, manipulative egomaniac. Before, Saturday night fever. After, Monday night football. Before, he makes me feel like $1 million. After, if I had a dime for every stupid thing he's done. Before, charming and noble. After, Chernobyl. Before, I can hardly believe we found each other. After, I can't believe I ended up with someone like you. But now, marriage doesn't always have to be a before and after. It can be love that's sustaining through those ups and down moments of life. But it can be growing deeper and deeper and more meaningful if we make the commitment, I love you, and I'm going to love you no matter what. I happen to know the wedding vows really good, but I found out memorizing them and saying them is easier than keeping them. And I'm talking about that part. For better, help me, what's the next one? For worse. For richer, for poorer. You ain't making enough money. Why don't you get another job? And there can be a lot of fusses about finances, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health. And we could go on through all of it. All of us remember them, we said them or acknowledged them, or maybe you were one of those couples that wrote your own vows. You know, I'm in this for 20 years and then I'm out. No, it's not a prison sentence. I'm just trying to say there has to be a commitment to love in a marriage. Number two, there has to be a commitment to a lasting marriage. Remember those words cleave and the words join together. They speak of a relationship bonded in an inseparable manner. Now, I realize they haven't always lasted. Some of you may be here and thinking this much. You're telling me to have a lasting marriage and I've been through a divorce already. Then you should be committed to this one to make it last. Maybe you've been through two. And listen, I've pastored people that have been through three, four, and five marriages. Well, what do you say when they get to number six? Please make this one last. I'm getting tired of repeating the vows. Make these things last. But don't you agree with me that we're living in an age when people sort of get in them and jump right out of them? It's almost like we're just going to try this out for a while like you would a used car. And I'm sorry, but a lady shouldn't be treated that way. A man shouldn't be treated that way. Marriage shouldn't be looked at. It is holy matrimony. It is something God designed. It's His idea. And we ought to try to make the thing last. So whatever you're in, I don't know if it's number one, number two, number three, number four, whatever it may be, make that one last by being committed to seeing it through no matter what. Jesus said in Matthew 19 and verse 6, wherefore there are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let no man put asunder. I'd put it another way too, if I could just fill in with that. No one or no thing ought to be there to bust up the lasting relationship, the sin of marriage. No other person ought to become you between you and your spouse, and no other thing. A dear preacher friend of mine, if I called his name, you'd know him. I respect him greatly. He said this. He'd gotten saved, but before he got saved, he got married before he got saved, and he was a serious coon hunter. I'm talking about the kind that goes out three or four times a week. He stays all night out. He said this. He said, I like to lose my marriage over coon hunting. And I said, I'm not a coon hunter. So I said, well, how? He said, I was gone all the time. He said, and then I got saved, and God put it on me that there was something more important than my coon hunting. And that was my wife and my children and my marriage. And he said, I gave up my coon hunting so I could make sure that my marriage worked. Now, for you, it might not be coon hunting. It might be fishing, hunting. It might be anything from a golf to a hobby, whatever it may be. And it could be on the woman's side or it could be on the man's side. We got something else that gets in the way. Can I encourage you? Make sure it's a lasting marriage. Don't be like the old widower who married this beautiful young bride. And he went to pick her up. It was back in the days when they traveled by a horse and buggy. And he rode up with a wagon and an old mule. And he helped her up onto the wagon. And just as they started, they hadn't gone a mile and the mule stumbled. And the old farmer, the old widower, said, that's one. They went a little bit further. The mule stumbled again and shook the wagon. The old widower said, that's two. They went a little bit further. And just as they pulled in the driveway, that mule stumbled one more time. And he said, that's three times. He reached under his seat and got his double-barrel shotgun, climbed down off the wagon, walked out front, and pointed that thing at the mule and shot him dead right there. And he fell over. And sure enough, he reached up there to try and help her down, and she said, she'd been quiet through this whole thing. She said, what in the world do you think you're doing? The mule just stumbled. Why in the world did you shoot him right there in the head? He said, that's one. So don't be like that, but be committed to a lasting marriage. It's got to last. Commitment will face its challenges during the course of a marriage, in any relationship, and times will face very serious tests. There'll be times when you have to stick by the commitment to stay together and when it will be stretched to its limits entirely. And I realize that there are difficulties us men face that maybe the women don't face. Any man here, raise your hand if you understand women. There are no hands up for those of you in the Facebook audience, and there never will be, because none of us guys fully understand you. I'm thinking of a story I heard of a man walking along a California beach. He was deep in prayer, and all of a sudden he said out loud, Lord, would you just grant me one wish? All of a sudden, above his head, the clouds began to circle. It got dark, and a big booming voice came out. The voice said this, because you have tried to be faithful to me in all ways, I will grant you one wish. What is that wish? He said, well, I want you to build for me, Lord, a bridge to Hawaii so that I can drive over there anytime I want to. Contrary to what some people think, there is no bridge to Hawaii. He won't make that clear. The Lord said back to him, your request is very materialistic. Think of the logistics of that kind of an undertaking. The supports required to reach the bottom of the Pacific Ocean, the concrete, the steel involved, and all that would take. I can do it. But it's hard for me to justify your desire for such a worldly thing. Take a little more time and think of another wish. A wish that you could think of that might honor and glorify me. And so the man thought for a long time. And finally he said, Lord, my wife says I don't understand her and I'm insensitive to her needs and I'm uncaring. I wish I could understand women. I want to know how they feel inside, what they are thinking about when they give the slightest of the silent treatment, why they cry, what they mean when they say nothing's wrong, and how I can make a woman truly happy. And after a few minutes, the Lord said, you want two lanes or four lanes on that bridge going away? You see, it's nigh to impossible to fix everything. So I'm talking to you today about having a commitment to a loving marriage because that's what God's code is. And to have a lasting marriage, it may seem impossible, it may seem hard, it may seem like even God could not make this thing last, but our commitment to it, I'm going to stick with this thing I call marriage, I'm going to stick with this person that I chose and selected, and by the grace of God, I'm trusting Him to help me. Thirdly, not only loving and lasting, but thirdly, a loyal marriage. Behind the whole ideal of a man cleaving to his wife and her to him is a loyal marriage. It's a matter of being loyal and faithful and having true fidelity in a relationship. Many researchers are now claiming that as many as half of all wives have affairs. One study suggested 3/4 of all wives married more than 5 years have fallen into some kind of an affair. Now, the Bible doesn't call it affair. The Bible calls it adultery. Fornication is another word used. It's a horrible thing. However, there is encouraging news. A recent study by the National Opinion Research Center, Chicago, Illinois University, said this. The rate of unfaithful husbands and wives is now at one of the all-time lows at only 3 to 4%. What that means is that 96 to 97% of people are staying faithful. Now, what do I draw from that? I draw from the statistics this, that God's design is the one that works the best, and the statistics prove it out. Yes, there's going to be some mistakes. There's going to be people that make bad choices. God created man with a free will. People are going to make bad choices along the way. But essentially, it's this, that if we'll follow God's way and do it His way and be loyal, it can be done. Husbands and wives can be faithful one to the other. They can stick by that, whatever the figures are, and they can go up or they can go down. But God's code of what is needed in a marriage, and what's needed in a family, and what's needed in a relationship is not going to change. There needs to be real love. There needs to be a real commitment to lasting and also to this idea of loyal. I read just recently a pastor in Alabama by the name of Fred Lowry put these words down, and he told the story about preaching in Oklahoma, and the pastor there, well, who's preaching for, told this story of a man who him and his wife were having, listen to this now, this will blow your mind. This man and his wife were having trouble so bad that she had decided to leave him. She made a decision on one evening that she was going to meet somebody at a local motel. She took her wedding band off and she put it on the kitchen sink.